Workers in Berks is supported by Southeastern PA Area Labor Federation.
Good evening. Welcome to this edition of Workers in Berks. My name is Stephanie Towles, and this program is sponsored by Berks Labor Council, and I'm the Education Secretary for the Labor Council. We have a very special program this evening, and I will tell you, it's not a live broadcast, so we will not be able to have callers, but my guest with me today is Congresswoman Chrissy Houlahan, who represents the 6th District. And we are so excited and happy to have her. Due to her busy schedule, we needed to pre-record today's program so that it'll be airing separately from when we recorded. So again, unfortunately, no phone calls today, but we are so excited to have you. And I would like to introduce Representative Houlahan. How are you?
I'm good, thank you. Thank you so much for having me today.
Well, thank you so much for coming. And it's really exciting to have you here. You have just kind of completed your freshman year, or you're mostly through that, and going down to Washington, D.C., had to have been a big move. I mean, we're watching you from here back home. But getting down there and getting yourself situated and representing the people of Berks County and Montgomery and West and
Chester.
Mm-hmm. I'm sorry, Berks and Chester. I'm always focused on Berks. But tell me a little bit about your first year.
Sure. So it's only been about 200 days so far, so we're about 6 or 7 months into our freshman year, and we are now home for an extended work period. And your time in Congress, a lot of people have a misunderstanding of what that's like. Effectively, it's 3 weeks out of every 4 you're down in Washington, D.C., and the 4th week you're here in the community. And so I've been doing that since about January. They literally swear you in, give you the keys to an office, and tell you to go. And so it's a lot like a startup. You know, you have to hire a really great team. You have to open offices in our community and offices down in D.C. And the very first day that I was on the job, I turned on the lights in our office in Reading. And so we're located in City Hall. It was a campaign promise that we would have a full-time office, and we have that in the Berks County area. And it's in the second floor of City Hall. And not only do we now have a full-time office there, but we also are open 2 evenings a week as well to make sure that people who have jobs, you know, during the day are able to access our services at night.
That's great. That's great to know that you're so available locally.
Absolutely.
And I had an opportunity to go to your D.C. office, and one of the things that I thought was really cool is that I got to sign the wall. You have like a sign-in wall for visitors.
Yep.
So when you said like a startup, that's what that reminded me of.
Exactly. What we have there is a wall where if you come from our community and you go down to Washington, we also have that at the Reading office and also in the Chester County office. You can put your stamp, you know, literally a star to indicate that you've been there, an initial or sign that as well, because we really just want to know that there's a sea of people, a star, a galaxy of people that are that we represent in our offices.
Well, that was good to know. It made me feel like I'm really a part of this because I'm right there on the wall now as I was leaving. What was your most surprising thing to learn as a freshman congresswoman?
So a couple of things that are surprising. I think that there's a narrative that follows congressional representatives around that somehow that people are really lazy and they don't really work terribly hard. And I probably was guilty of assuming that. And when I got down to Washington and when I'm here now in our community, what I'm struck by is the 430 or so souls that are down in Washington who serve in the Congress, the House of Representatives, work very, very, very hard. Regardless of whether or not you agree with them on every issue, you can know that they're down there representing their communities. And what I also have been struck by is that it is a job in D.C., it's a job here in your community, and it's a job to make sure that you continue to understand what people want you to legislate on and how to serve them. And so that was a surprise to me. The other thing that's been a surprise to me is that there really is a spirit of camaraderie, there really is a spirit of bipartisan community there. It's not really talked about in the news or in the media, but there are individual people who are working very hard across the aisle and through the spectrum of all of our beliefs to work together.
That's good to know, because from sitting home and reading the papers and watching television, it seems like there's just kind of a stalemate and that things aren't happening. But I do understand that there were things that passed through the House of Representatives successfully last year, and some of those things are things that would very much be affecting our labor, our unions, our workers here in Berks County. But once they got through the House of Representatives, we haven't heard about them again. So can you just kind of explain what happens there?
And we have been very, very busy at the House of Representatives. It's called the People's House for a reason, because we are responsible to the people. And we have, in the 6 or so months that I've been down there, we have passed almost 300 pieces of legislation through the House. Those 300 pieces of legislation have run the gamut from healthcare to ethics in government, making sure that we hold ourselves accountable and that the vote matters that people place and that money is taken out of politics, to gun safety and gun violence, to the environment, affordable healthcare. But relevant to this conversation, a lot of that 300 pieces of legislation have had to do with workers. One in particular, Butch Lewis, passed last 2 or 3 weeks ago at this point in time, talks about protecting pensions, right? Mm-hmm. We also passed a $15 minimum wage act as well. For our community, I'm very much in support of a living wage, making sure that people are paid appropriately and that a full-time job means that you can support yourself and your family. And $15 in our community in many cases is not enough, but we were able to pass that. We were able to pass as well a lot of different things that I think that would have been beneficial to, you know, workers. And unfortunately, all of those languish in the Senate right now. And of the 300 or so, sorry, I will go backward and say another one that we passed was the Cadillac tax. And so many of us who have health care through our employers, and many workers do, were really worried about this Cadillac tax that was going to be burdening them, in some cases 40% incremental tax. Again, the House of Representatives passed the fact that we would permanently repeal that tax and delivered that and the other things to the floor, to the door of the Senate. Of the 300 or so things that we've passed, only about 20 have made it to the president's desk for signature. So the large, vast, vast majority of the things that we have been working so diligently on for the people are not making it through the pipeline in the Senate.
Wow. So it's not necessarily that that nothing is getting done, but it's that the things that are getting done are kind of like then like bottlenecked or cut off from moving forward. But once something has passed in the House, it's pretty much out of your hands. I mean, the Senate has to pass it forward for it to go to the president. So
exactly. It needs to go forward to a vote for the Senate, and the Senate can vote for it and send it back to the House, and we can reconcile it, which is frankly what we're doing right now with the Defense Appropriations Bill and part of the Armed Services Committee. But effectively, the next step is that the Senate has to vote on it. And I don't know, I'm of the generation that remembers Schoolhouse Rock, you know, I'm just a bill, just an ordinary bill. And that is the process that needs to happen. It needs to go to Capitol Hill, and then it needs to go to committee, and then it needs to go to, you know, the House and the Senate, and then eventually it'll get to the president's desk for signature. Otherwise it dies.
Well, it's kind of a you know, it's good to know that things are happening and that issues are being worked on and talked about and language is being put together, but it's disheartening to know that it's just not getting to the level where we're seeing it in our community yet, where the changes are actually able to take place by becoming laws. And one of the things that I understand that the House did, because the financial and the budget responsibilities are in the House, is that they created a farm bill that had all of the amounts that were going to be appropriated for the different projects were already determined. But I heard on the news that there is some pushback there. Can you explain what's happening and who that affects? Because when I say the farm bill, this is not something that only affects farmers. The farm bill affects every community. And maybe you can explain.
Sure, and I'll just highlight one part of it. I mean, in Berks County and in Chester County, which is also part of our district, we do have a very large agricultural community. We have the nation's largest mushroom farms in the country. We also have dairy farms. And so, of course, making sure we think about agriculture is important. And I actually hosted Secretary Perdue, the Secretary of Agriculture, in our community to talk about those issues. But in the farm bill, there are also issues like SNAP, you know, food benefits for people, many of them working people and many of them retirees as well, hardworking people who are living on minimum incomes, going back to the minimum wage conversation, the living wage conversation. And because they are in the agriculture or in the farm bill purview, there has been some conversation recently about decreasing the appropriations for SNAP benefits particularly. I and a number, very, very many of us, both in the House and in the Senate, have on the 8th of August, which was just a few days ago, written a letter to Secretary Perdue saying it's unacceptable for us to be reducing these kinds of benefits, because these benefits are for the very people they're intended to serve, the working poor, the working class. Mm-hmm. And I just actually came from here. I was visiting a housing center that houses retirees. They are making $12,000 a year, and they are eligible for SNAP benefits as well. And so we just need to take care of the people who take care of us.
Yes, yes, it's important that we do. One of the things that happens to get things through legislatively is that you create coalitions and you have partnerships, and there are some people that you work with closely and are like-minded with. Mm-hmm. And so I'd like to throw out some of these names of some of these groups that you're in. They all have little catchy phrases. So first, the G9. Can you tell us about the G9 and sure. your involvement with them?
So one of the things, I ran for Congress for a lot of different reasons, but ran for Congress for 2 years. And I started learning that the issues of our community were healthcare, you know, good jobs that treated one another with dignity, good education that allowed us to access those jobs, a safe community and a safe planet. You know, those were the obvious kitchen table issues, the things that everybody, you know, bread and butter issues. But what came out as an issue in the campaign was that the largest thing was decency, right? Civility, working together, serving together became mm-hmm. a real issue of the campaign. And I saw this here in our community, and I also saw it with a lot of the people who ran with me. Many of us ran for office for the very first time from all over the country, and many of us, like me, had service backgrounds. I served in the military. I'm third generation military. I also served through Teach for America. I was a teacher of chemistry in North Philadelphia, and there were a lot of people who were running for the very first time with these service heritages and backgrounds, whether mm-hmm. military or CIA or Teach for America, Peace Corps. And so the G9 is a group of Democrats, newly elected Democrats, who are down in Washington, all of us first-time candidates, who are down there for the first time to serve and to find, you know, common ground, pragmatic solutions. Mm-hmm. And so we have in common this service heritage. And we know that we're all in it for the same reason, and we know that we're all in it to reset civility, to heal the country, to fill that mission that we have. And so even though we may not share all the same ideas, we are constantly talking to one another because we trust each other.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's good, and that's not the kind of discourse that I see take place when I watch the nightly news about what's happening in Congress.
It's not terribly exciting when people actually get along and they have different ideas, but they get along. That's mm-hmm. not terribly exciting. It doesn't tend to make the news.
Well, coming from that military background or that service background, that gives you all that kind of common setting. The Four Country Caucus, that is also people with similar backgrounds, or can you explain
sure.
that? Because that's a little bit different. That's a separate group from your G9.
Sure.
This is another group that you meet.
So a caucus, and I'm starting to also realize that not a lot of people, because many of us have not been tuned into government, me included, until recently. A caucus is just a group of people that come together under a common umbrella, right? And they come together to communicate with one another. And this group called Four Country is a really unique caucus in Washington because it's 9 Republicans and 10 Democrats, so we're bipartisan. We all have service backgrounds. We've all served in the military in our pasts. But we don't have really necessarily anything ideologically in common. We may come from the far right, we may come from the far left, we may not come from the same places in the country, mm-hmm. but we really have this service heritage and this idea that we need to find our common ground. And so we come together, even though we probably won't find a lot that we agree on, to make sure that we can at least have conversations that are hard to have. Mm-hmm. And so that's what this new organization is. And we meet once a week or so, and we sit together and we try to find things that we can work on. And I'll give you an example of one of the things that we think we can work on. We are a broken nation. We're not talking to one another right now. We're not able to have conversations, civil conversations with one another. And we think, this group of us, thinks that the part of the reason is that we don't have this spirit of national service any longer. And so it could be that we're serving in the military. It could be that we are doing something like teaching together, something like City Year or Peace Corps. Mm-hmm. But some sort of a national service ethos is really important. And whether we come from the left or the right, we think that there are times in our lives when we're young or when we're old where we have to come together and we have to collide with people that we don't know. Mm-hmm. And that's something that we collectively are advocating for.
Mm-hmm. I think that's so important. And when you look at the fact that this country has had our military actively engaged for the past almost 20 years, and the percentage of people and families that are affected by it, because they have family members that are serving or because they're active themselves, and then you look at the people who are so disconnected from that and who are just enjoying life without realizing the daily sacrifices that so many people are going through. I think it's very important to have people with knowledge and understanding of that be together and help to push the country forward on making decisions that respect and understand that background and what it's like to make that commitment.
Yeah, only 1% of our population serves in the military. And about 20% of our government on the House side and Senate side have served in the military. But importantly, this isn't just some sort of a military, you know, recognition. It's any sort of service, because when you work in Teach for America or Peace Corps or City Year or any of those great organizations that allow VISTA, that allow us to come together, we're going to be with people who we haven't had the opportunity to meet before. Mm-hmm. And that's where we have real conversations and real relationships with people who are not like us. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, we're in our little Twitter spheres or Facebook groups or whatever we are. We're so virtual at this point in time that we're not seeing each other. Mm-hmm. And I think that's causing us to be more divided than we should be.
There's another group that I've heard your name associated with, and that's the Fab Four. And I'm old enough to know what that's a throwback to, but I bet there are some people in our audience that don't. But the Fab Four, can you explain what our local Fab Four is?
Sure. So we have a local group that's called the Fab Four, and what that is four southeastern Pennsylvanian women who were just recently elected to Congress. And so Pennsylvania has 18 congressional seats. Until January this year, none of them were occupied by women. Historically, only 7 women have ever been in Congress from Pennsylvania, from the state of Pennsylvania, and only 3 of those were ever duly elected. The rest were spouses of people who had served before. And so it was pretty cool when 4 newly elected women came into Congress all at the same time, and so we got named the Fab Four. And we are all from southeastern Pennsylvania, and so in unifying ourselves under this kind of mantle, we're trying to attack the issues that we have in common, and there are most of mm-hmm. the issues. So gun safety and gun violence issues were sort of the first issues that we tackled together. On the very same day, we joined a caucus, a task force group that talks about gun safety and gun violence, basically making a collective statement that the 4 of us are together on this issue, and we're making sure that people collectively know that this is an important issue to us. 3 of the 4 of us brought to the State of the Union a guest. You're allowed to invite 1 guest that had mm-hmm. to do with this issue, had to do with gun safety or gun violence. Again, elevating this conversation and saying it was important to our region. We also collectively talk about opioid addiction, which is, I think, something that all of our communities struggle with. But we, again, wanted to make sure that people understood that we were unified on this issue. And so mm-hmm. whether it's, you know, grabbing a drink after votes, and sometimes votes can go as late as midnight or 1 o'clock, you know, or just chatting on our text messaging, we mm-hmm. can check in with each other and see where people stand on different issues for Pennsylvania.
So that's a real nice kind of behind-the-scenes look at what's happening. So often, even if you do turn to C-SPAN or you watch the what's happening on the floor, you may see one or two people talking, and then you see the empty spaces in the background, and you wonder if anybody's communicating together.
Yeah.
Oh, please do.
Yeah, so one of the things that just surprised the heck out of me when you ask what surprises you when you get to Washington is I'm one of those people who watched C-SPAN and said, where is everybody, right? Mm-hmm. And how can our government work when nobody's there? And what I discovered is I'm a freshman, I'm a member of three committees. Normally you're a member of two, I'm a member of three. The Armed Services Committee, the Foreign Affairs Committee, and the Small Business Committee. And within each of those committees, you can be assigned to subcommittees. So I'm on five subcommittees. And so those committees and subcommittees can literally be meeting at the very same time. And so what you're doing as a member is you're rotating from committee to committee. And so when you look on C-SPAN, and you see empty chairs and you wonder where everyone is. Mm-hmm. I have put on any given day as much as 7 miles of walking from one place to another because you're rotating around. And so to the floor, when sometimes you see the floor is empty as well, that's when you're effectively arguing for a bill or an amendment. You get a certain amount of time, very few people are there, and then you come for votes, and that's when you see everybody come. So that was another thing that I was surprised by, definitely.
Well, when we see things coming up that we as local citizens have strong opinions about, how should we be letting your office know what is important to us, what our priorities are, and what we want you to be paying attention to? What can I do to make sure that I'm being heard?
So that's a terrific question, and there are so many things that you can do to advocate for yourself. And one of the things that I think has gotten a pretty bad name, I think unnecessarily, is lobby. The word lobby, you know, it has a negative connotation. It more is like advocacy, right? If something's important to you, you should advocate for it. And that means you should either come to our office in Reading or our office down in Westchester or down to Washington, D.C. and lobby. If you can't do that, you know, find a group that can advocate for you. Make sure that you are associated with a group like that. You're welcome to call our offices and tell people what it is that you're interested in, and we will take a note and write you back. You're also welcome to email us or mail us. We've received 40,000 emails, I think, since I've been in office, five or so thousand letters or and emails. It's a lot of volume that's coming through the office. And the next thing that I would say is because there's so much volume, there are 7,000 bills every 2 years that are introduced in the House. If there's something that's important to you, like the Butch Lewis Act, see something, say something, because this is an office that's tiny. We are 18 people strong. And to see 7,000 things whip by and tens of thousands of calls whip by, we need to see aggregate information to make sure that we know that it's something our community cares about.
So if I call your office, and I don't necessarily get to speak to you, but if I call your office and I talk to whomever is on the phone, that information is then somehow generated to you, they're counting how many people called about each issue to let you know what we're thinking and feeling?
Exactly. So every Monday and Friday, we sit together as a team. We talk about what's coming through the calls or the letters, and we look at what is happening in terms of legislation on the floor. We are very importantly, deliberately designed as a district-driven office. So we're looking for people from our community to tell us what's important to them instead of the other way around. We're not trying to fit Washington solutions into our communities. We're trying to ask what's happening in our communities and what are the solutions in Washington that can be helpful. So yes, we sit down and we look at those things. One thing that I would ask for of our community is, I was a teacher for a time, and when I was a teacher, one of the biggest joys I had was being able to call people and their parents and say, great job on this test, or good job, with helping a friend. If you see something good, call me too. Don't just call me when it's a bad thing. Call me when it's a good thing. Because frankly, it's hard when everything is negative to see what people really want. Because the majority of people may not call you if something good is happening. The majority of people might call you if they're unhappy. And I do need to hear from people.
Okay, well, as a teacher, I make those calls and send those notes, and so I do know, and that's also a fun call to make, mm-hmm. To be able to say, hey, you got that right.
Exactly.
You heard me.
Exactly.
And I hope that we'll be making lots of those calls as we go into the fall, and you go back after August and Congress reconvenes. Is there anything coming down the pipeline that you're particularly looking at or think is going to be?
Well, this is the time when a lot of the work that we've done in the House will hopefully marry up with some of the work that's happening in the Senate with budgets. So I do serve on the Armed Services Committee, and so mm-hmm. hopefully a good budget will be passed for the Armed Services. I also serve on Foreign Affairs, so that's humanitarian efforts, diplomatic efforts. Hopefully mm-hmm. good things will happen there. There is some movement, it would seem, on the NAFTA 2.0 or AFTA-NAFTA or the USMCA is what it's called. This is the kind of new trade deal. It's looking as though there's some good progress in the working groups there, particularly on the three issues that we have asked for consideration on. One is making sure that there's better accommodations for labor. Another is better accommodations for environmental reconciliation, because different countries do things differently in the environment, as they do with labor as well. And the last thing that we've demanded before we will see this, you know, as a vote, mm-hmm. is to make sure that a relatively big issue that has to do with prescription drug pricing needs to be accommodated too. Mm-hmm. Because I was elected on health care, and I want to make sure that we have better, more affordable health care. Mm-hmm. So those are the three sticking points on that, and it sounds as though, as of right now, that there's progress mm-hmm. being made on those.
Well, I'm sure the Labor Council and the different unions are going to be paying very close attention to that, because that's one of the areas where we're really glad to hear that our voices are at the table mm-hmm. As you're making those decisions. And those of you at home, I just talked to you, and Congresswoman Houlahan just talked to you about how you can make your voice heard on that with her and her office, as you see that coming up in the news, and letting her know how you feel about it. I want to thank you so much for joining me this evening.
It's a pleasure.
This has been a really good opportunity to learn a little bit more about the ins and outs and the behind the scenes. And I'm so glad to have you down there in Washington representing us. And I hope that you'll come join us again.
Thank you. I appreciate it very much. Thanks for having me.
Okay. Thank you. That is all for this episode of Workers in Berks. And we will see you again next month. Have a pleasant evening. Good night.
Workers in Berks is supported by Southeastern PA Area Labor Federation.